bit ominous that we're seeing the end of the whole season lands on the episode called Cancer Cell Part 2. We see now the natural killer cells uses this hunting knife looking thing and that it lights up. And I think this is a metaphor for when natural killer cells are detecting infected threats. In the last episode, I talked about the potential link this show is trying to build between bacteria and cancer, and this could turn out to be a really important plot point on how things will result on the other side of the battlefield where we see our protagonist fighting off the cancer cell. This kind of reminds me of those really cool and smart action movies where you see the main protagonist fighting off the bad guy in the forefront, but actually in the background, you see this other team of experts that are secretly working to lay the groundwork. So it's not just the immune cells. The good bacteria in our gut are also helping to fight off the cancer. And did you know this? There are actually more bacteria cells living in our gut than there are human cells in our body. This is really funny because some bacterial infections can lead to diarrhea that are just so stinky. And the first thing I can think of is C. difficile infection. So we always advise patients, if you're getting diarrhea that just smells extremely nasty and smells really bad, make sure you go to the doctor to get that checked out because it could be a C. difficile infection. And our nose can smell the poop from C. difficile infection. We've actually trained dogs to smell the C. difficile bacteria. Yes, there are puppy staff that have been trained to actually smell the C. difficile bacteria before they infect someone's gut and causes that person to have diarrhea. And this is super important because even with meticulous cleaning, we can still miss spots around the hospital. But if we have this lovely puppy who's been trained to smell bacteria and they just patrol around the hospital, they can help us pinpoint where we have missed. I really like the writing at this plot because the cancer cell is now keeping the neutrophil in this cage. So in the show, it looks like the neutrophil wants to fight, can't fight, but now is not able to. But in reality, we know that neutrophils can't actually directly kill cancer cells. They can only kill bacteria. I really like the fact that anime uses this sort of explanation using plot points to kind of keep him at bay. And you notice the cancer cell keeps targeting the natural killer cell and the T cells, who are actually the ones that can kill him. Again, very clever points from the show. Oh, that's really cool. Do you see that animation on cell division? You can even see the spindle fibers that's pulling the cells apart and making two identical cells side by side. Love this animation. He changed his cap? Whoa, that means he's transforming into a memory T cell right now. Is he also gonna have his little memory book that he's gonna flip through? That was really cute. So when there is a tumor burden, yes, we use the fancy word burden, the killer T cells will cause the death of cancer cells through apoptosis. And after the tumor burden has been cleared, a small fraction of these killer T cells will turn into memory T cells. And when the cancer recurs in this case, so for example, even if a few small numbers of cancer cells still survive, or if they come back years later, now we have these memory T cells, which can work so much faster. But of course, in real life scenarios, the cancer cells are really, really smart and they learn to quickly adapt and now can escape our own immune system. What? Did I predict this as well? I don't know if you remember this, but in episode 3, I actually commented that the show is really clever in showing the T cells using their fists as weapons. We see all the other cells having some sort of actual weapon, right? Our neutrophil has a small dagger, the macrophage has a big cleaver, and we see the NK cell has this sort of hunting knife. But the T cell doesn't have anything, they just use their fists. And I actually said in that episode, I think it's because the way T cells attack other cells is through something called perforin, which is like punching a hole through the other cell. Okay, I think just for this, you should give this video a like and please subscribe to help support my channel.
T 細胞パープリンキャルンパンティっての
は I'm sure the jokes sound way funnier in Japanese. Unfortunately, I don't understand the puns. Are there any native Japanese speakers in the audience? Please let me know what the cancer cell said.
パープリンキャルンパンティ
Why is he crying?
パープリンキラー T 細胞が感染細胞やがん細胞
Yes, and that's exactly why I said it was clever for this show to use T-cells punches as a weapon. Is this show stealing my line? Okay, I'll go a little bit deeper into perforin. After the T-cell recognizes a cancer cell, it attaches itself to the cancer cell. And it creates this kind of sealed docking site where the T-cell can release toxic chemicals into the cancer cell without damaging any of the other healthy cells around the environment. And at this point, the T-cell will release perforin into the cancer cell. And perforin, just from the name, can you guess what it does? It creates pores in the cancer cell. And then through these pores, the T cells can now release toxic chemicals like granzymes, and then they will basically tell the tumor cells to go kill themselves.
Kill yourself.
Don't you love it when everything just comes together in a show? Oh, this is some Bruce Lee stuff. With the noises too. God, she's still here. This lady, why is she always in the way? Okay, fine. That's her job. I briefly mentioned in part one of this video that regulatory T cells are kind of the key points to how cancer can escape our own immune system. Also in that video, I said we usually call them T-Rex, and I made a joke about T-Rex. Sorry, cell lady, I know that's kind of mean. But we're gonna do it again. So tumors can actually attract T-Rex. I remember in the last part, there was one line said by the tumor cells, now I've got regulatory T-cells on my side. So yeah, that's absolutely true. The tumor cell, by releasing a bunch of chemicals, can actually recruit a lot of T-Rex. And it ends up being there will be a lot more regulatory T cells than killer T cells. So it creates this imbalance in the system. And then regulatory T cells obviously will downregulate killer T cells, and sometimes even by directly killing them. Oh! She's seen him practicing this, but her face is giving, what the heck is this idiot doing? He's crying again? She just dodged out of the way. That's so funny. Yes! Okay, finally! So when do T-Rex actually start to recognize that cancer cells should be killed? Well, in the real body, it's actually pretty hard. Because the job of T-Rex is to help preserve our self-cells. And cancer comes from ourselves, so they express a lot of the self proteins. I'm glad in this show the lady finally turned sides, but in real life, not as much. Okay, she thinks he's CLL? What does that mean? In cancer, that's actually called chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Is that what she thinks this cell is? But I thought we were in the gut, and it would be really weird to see a leukemia cell in the gut. Oh! Okay, never mind, it's not leukemia. She's just saying that he's missing a letter on his shirt because some of the part of the word is covered by the blood splatter, and now she doesn't recognize that he's a normal cell anymore. Yeah, okay, my bad. I read too much into this.
制御性 T 細胞の働き、がん細胞の何らかの変化によって
Right, so like I said, unfortunately for us, T-Rex don't stop working just because the killer T-cell asked her to. As long as they don't see this cancer cell being dangerous, they won't stop being this annoying. But I mentioned in part one of this episode that we've actually found a way to downregulate T-regulatory cell activity. And we use these drugs all the time. They're called immunotherapy drugs, and in this specific case, they're called checkpoint inhibitors. So just to quickly explain to you how they work, we found these off switches on the surface of T-Rex. And what these off switches normally do is they tell the killer T-cells to turn off. For example, we have this drug called ipilimumab. We just call it IP because the full name is just too hard to say. These drugs actually kill the switches. So the T-Rex now can't actually tell the killer T-cells to stop working. Okay, good. So without the T-Rex, our immune cells are back to work again. But in reality, if our immune system is so good at doing its job, why can't we keep cancer at bay? And like I said earlier, the cancer cells are just too good at learning how to mutate and adapt and escape our system. When cancer first appear, they have these ID tags on them that basically mark them as dangerous, and these are called MHC molecules. And when the immune cells recognize these, they flood to the site and try to kill it. But the cancer really quickly learns how to hide these ID tags, so it's kind of like that sneaky roommate who always changes their Wi-Fi password. And by the time the T-cells now realize it's been tricked, the cancer has invited a million of his other friends and invaded the apartment space. You know what this giant reminds me of? Yeah, I actually had tickets to see the Attack on Titan live concert a couple months ago, but on the day of the concert, my dog really deteriorated, so I decided to not go to the concert but stay home with her. She passed away the next day. Sit! Down? Sit! Shake! Other hand! Good girl! But it was the best decision ever made. Oh. I feel like this is a very good visual representation for metastases. Oh, is that what we're gonna see here? You've got this main big tumor, which we call the primary tumor site, which I feel like is represented by this giant that we see here. And then you see our original cancer cells with wings flying away. And in cancer, there's something called micrometastases, which are these individual cancer cells that it's so hard to detect on imagings and scans, and they could really travel anywhere, any distance in your body. And it's really interesting because different kinds of tumors have a tendency to travel to different sites. Like breast cancer very commonly will travel to the bones. Colorectal cancer will commonly travel to the liver and other areas in the gut. Lung cancer can commonly travel to the brain. I wonder if this is the end for this body. Oh, did she do it? No, she can't. Interesting. Okay, so he says normally he can feel like there's a boost in his power, but now that's gone. And I don't know if you noticed, when his wings got slashed, you see that purple stuff that I think is supposed to represent the toxins from the bacteria start to fade away. So I think we were right. This is colorectal cancer. And I'm super glad that this show is talking about gut health, because gut health is one of the ways we can actually prevent cancer. I mentioned in the last video that we are now testing this new cancer treatment that takes the poop of someone else and you insert that into your own body. And I'll go into that a little bit more here. And studies have shown that in bad gut health, the bad bacteria in the gut can actually help to damage DNA and help cancer processes. So then we thought, if there are bad bacteria that can make cancer worse, would there be good bacteria that can make cancer better? And surprisingly, there is. So they've actually found there are specific microbial species that can help immunotherapy drugs to work better. And the concept of having a foreign pathogen like bacteria or virus to cause cancer isn't anything new. We already know there are certain viruses and bacteria that can cause cancer. For example, the HPV virus, the hepatitis B virus, and for bacteria, the H. pylori, they together cause about 20% of all the cancers worldwide. And interestingly, when I was younger, I had recurrent H. pylori infections that were misdiagnosed for the longest time, and it caused stomach ulcers in the past. Although now that I've been treated, it has led to some chronic stomach issues on my part. So I think that might be an interesting story to share, so maybe eventually I'll share that on this channel. But the fact that we have more bacteria cells living in our gut than there are human cells that we have, of course, that's so much knowledge that we have to tap into to see what kind of bacteria are good for cancer and what kinds are bad. And the first thing that we looked at is there actually a difference between the gut flora of a cancer patient versus a healthy patient? Because if there's no difference, then maybe we're looking at the wrong path. And it turns out, yes, there is a difference. So this caused more and more studies to look into the possible effectiveness of having this poop transplant therapy. trying to get sympathy again. Yeah, I don't think that's gonna work at this point. You basically kept the white blood cell in a cage this whole two episodes, so I don't think he's gonna feel bad for you either. All right, that's it for the grand finale of Cells at Work Season 2. I think this was such a good show. It has so many interesting medical topics, and it doesn't matter what your knowledge level for medicine is. You could be a total beginner. You could go into this completely blank without knowing anything about medicine and learn a lot of new information, or you could already have a lot of knowledge about medicine, but there are so many cool, interesting Easter eggs that are still presented in this show. And I had so much fun just overanalyzing this whole series and picking out these little subtle details that the show presents to us. I hope you enjoyed the series too. I'll put the link to the whole playlist here so you can watch everything. And if you've enjoyed this video, please don't forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more contents like this. And I'll see you in the next one. Bye!